throats of faith and deepest fear. So afraid of failing if you move on from here. The road ahead is steep, but you're not giving up, 'cause God's about to take you to a brand new place of trust. Take a step of faith. It's time to move. Lay aside your fears and watch what God will do. There's victory ahead. That mountain's not too high. Friend, hold on, 'cause you're beyond what you have dreamed, and they're yours for the taking if you dare to believe. So leave your doubts behind and let God make you brave, 'cause he has gone before you and he's already made the way.
Take a step of faith. It's time. Lay aside your fears and watch what God will do. There's victory ahead. That mountain's not too high. Friend, hold on, 'cause you're about to climb.
You may feel you can't go on, and it just seems too hard, but if you'll put your hand,
step of faith. It's time to move. Lay aside your fears and watch what God will do. There's victory ahead. That mountain's not too high. Friend, hold on, 'cause you're about to climb. There's
beyond what you have dreamed, and they're yours for the taking if you dare to believe. So leave your doubts behind and let God make you brave, 'cause he has gone before you and he's already made the way.
Take a step of faith. It's time. Watch what God will do. There's victory ahead. That mountain's not too high. Friend, hold on, 'cause you're about to climb.
You may feel you can't go on, and it just seems too hard, but if you'll put your hand in his, he will take you through.
What God will do. There's victory ahead. That mountain's not too high. Friend,
Sermons the past couple of weeks, we started talking about it during choir practice, and somebody mentioned the fact that 20% of the folks do about 80% of the work around a church, and Brother Alton's sermons are not designed to put anybody on the spot. It's so that you can be blessed, so that the Lord can bless you in your life for being used, for being willing to get out and do something for Him. We all have, and we mentioned it in the practice, we all, if we're all honest, none of us are 100% where we need to be in our service to the Lord. If we'd be honest tonight, there's no way we'd raise our hand and say, yes, I'm right where I need to be in service to the Lord. We're not given what we should give. And while they were singing, I thought about this song because of what he said. We all have an Isaac. We all have an Isaac. We all have something, some reason we're holding on to something why we can't do something. I can't do because of this, or I don't want to get involved in that because it's going to take too much of my time. And it's not good. We all have an Isaac. And the Lord doesn't want our Isaac, though. He wants us. Listen to the story in the song.
Abraham prayed for the day God would give him a son. Blessed Isaac was his name, the greatest gift he'd ever known. Then came the day, who would have dreamed God would say, give him back to me. And on this mountain you will prove it's you and Isaac, or it's me and you. And when I most of us, I dare to say, we have an Isaac that is standing in God's way. And on this altar, it's where you will prove it's not your Isaac that God wants. He just wants you. God was wanting me on this altar, altar where he lay. Oh, it's justified that it wasn't him. God wanted me. surrender all to Him. I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him. In His presence I daily live. Oh yes, I surrender all. Oh, I surrender my all. All to Thee. That it wasn't Him, God was wanting me, and on this altar where He lay, oh, it's justified that it wasn't Him, God wanted me.
I'm a little perplexed right now. I got a message right here. But the Lord woke me up with a song today. And I felt like I was supposed to share it with you. It doesn't fit with anything we've done here tonight. I don't guess. And then I got up here and I realized I left it downstairs on my desk. But I was sure that the Lord gave it to me when I got in the car to come to the church. But I can't remember. You want to try to find it for me? It's on my desk. Good luck. And it says, okay, it's one piece of paper, has full on the one side and just a little bit on the back, and it says Hallelujah Square on it. But if you have your Bibles, turn to 2 Timothy in chapter 3. We are so blessed to have the Word of God. There's just not enough that we can say as Christians about God's Word. It takes us from the beginning of time, and then it also goes to the extreme other end. And takes us to the very end of time. It takes us from a place when there was not time to a place where there will be no more time. That's exciting. And I can't help but thank you, brother. I appreciate you finding that. The fact you were able to find that means you have good eyes and God is with us. thank you, my friend. Thank you. So I really don't know how this is going to fit. I just don't. But and now somebody's texting me, so I don't know what's going on here. Let's see. Y'all might have to read my text here. Let's see. You know what, Miss Mildred said, I don't know what I'm going to do with all you boys playing with your phones during church. But if you remember, back in the day when I was a boy, we didn't have the phone here. It was a big old red honker hooked up to the wall over here. I don't know about West Side, but there was a big old red phone. And the preacher would be sitting there during the song service, and all of a sudden he'd be on the phone. He'd be talking to somebody in the church about something going on, like the sound booth or so forth. Well, we don't have the big old red honker hanging on the wall anymore. And so a lot of times things are going on during church. I'm taking care of them. Sometimes I'll look out here and some of you are fanning. And so I'll reach down and flip over a few little things and cut the air conditioner on for you. Isn't that nice? And sometimes I'll look over and I'll see somebody freezing. And I'll even bump it up a degree every now and then when I want to have a little mercy on Miss Pina, when she needs a little blessing. But I woke up, and I have not heard this song in forever. I'll be honest with you, this song has not crossed my mind in decades. And you know I'm not a singer. You know I don't do that well. But I woke up with this song in my heart, and I just want to share it with you. And you may remember it, Hallelujah Square. Do y'all remember that? Man, I feel old. Of course, when I heard it sung, it was sung with a twang. I'm sure y'all may remember that. I don't know if I should try to sing it or just read it. Read it. See, we got a church split going on. Sing it, read it. Sing it with some twang. But I was thinking yesterday, I was riding down the road, and maybe a day before, and there was a song on that made me think about what it's going to be like when we get to heaven. And I don't know if that's where this came from, but the lyrics go like this. I saw a blind man tapping along, losing his way as he passed through the throng. Tears filled my eyes. I said, friend, you can't see. But with a smile on his face, he replied to me, I'll see all my friends in Hallelujah Square. What a wonderful time we'll all have up there. We'll sing and praise Jesus, his glory to share. And you'll not see one blind man in Hallelujah Square. Key change. I saw a cripple dragging his feet. He couldn't walk like we do down the street. I said, my friend, I feel sorry for you. But he said, up in heaven, I'm going to walk just like you. And the chorus says, I'll see all my friends in Hallelujah Square. What a wonderful time we'll all have up there. We'll sing and praise Jesus, his glory to share. And you'll not see one cripple in Hallelujah Square. Then it says, key change. I saw an old man gasping for breath. Soon he'd be gone as his eyes closed in death. He looked at me and said, friend, don't look so blue. For I'm going up to heaven. How about you? I'll see all my friends in Hallelujah Square. What a wonderful time we'll all have up there. We'll sing and praise Jesus, his glory to share, and we'll all live forever in Hallelujah Square. I'm glad we've got the Word of God. I'm glad we've got these songs. But because we have this book, we have, according to 1st or 2nd Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16, we have a scripture that is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That the man of God, that the woman of God, that the Christian be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Ladies and gentlemen, we know these things, we have these things because of the inspiration of God's Word. There's things we know and understand because we have this book. Because we have this book, we can live and do and act and be what God wants us to be and do what he wants us to do because of this book. Without this instruction manual, we would all be in trouble. We've got a dog. And that dog this morning, while we were getting ready for church, decided to start chasing its tail. And it went around and around and around, and the dog could not catch its tail, and it began to bark at its tail. And the more frustrated it became, the more it barked. And I tell you, it reminded me, as Christians that do not plant their lives in this inspired Word of God, this book, and we spend our Christian walk chasing our tail, barking, making a lot of noise, but never achieving what we want to achieve in our Christian walk. But yet, if we'll just follow the instruction in righteousness, this book can change our lives. I don't remember if I shared this with you or not, but I know back in February of 09, I shared this illustration, and I'll be honest with you, I can't remember if I've done this recently or not, that there is a true illustration. George Truett mentioned when King William IV died that there was a woman, a young lady, and she was sleeping in the palace. She was awakened. She was told as a young girl that she was now Queen of England. As soon as she realized the weight that had fallen upon her, she fell on her knees and asked God for help to guide her. And through all the years that followed, for 64 years, this girl who was Queen Victoria reigned over the British Empire. During her reign, it said that England was never made greater progress than while she was queen. The Prince of India asked her what the secret was of England's power, and her answer was quiet, but it was sure when she picked up the Bible that was on a nearby table, and holding the Bible, she said, "This is the secret." She said the book was God's Word, the Bible. I want to say that this book, because of this book, it has made a difference in our lives. It's made a difference in nations. It's made a difference in the way leaders have led their people because of this holy book. Because of this book, we understand the message of redemption. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 6 and 7 says, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have been redeemed. Now, how have we been redeemed according to this book? We've been redeemed through his blood. The forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. How do we know about the blood? How do we know about the grace of Jesus that we may stand and sing, wonderful grace of Jesus, greater than all our sins? How can we stand and sing, amazing grace, how sweet thy sound? We can stand and sing about the graciousness of God because of what we've learned from this book. We can sing and read, and we learn from this book, this thing of eternal life. That as God's children, it's not some elusive idea. It's not like nailing Jell-O to the wall. But this thing of eternal life is our possession. And we learn this through this book. 1 John 5, verse 13 begins to tell us, these things have I written unto you. These things have I written unto you. What? That believe on the name of the Son of God. Without this book, we could not know the Son of God. We would not have the instruction to know who he is and what he's done. And therefore, we could not possess this thing called eternal life. That ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. God gave us this holy word that we may know that we possess eternal life. Because of God's word, because of this book, we have learned that we can have this eternal life. But we've learned that we can have confidence. We've learned that we can have fearless confidence. It breaks my heart with people that struggle with understanding and knowing for sure that they have this precious possession that God has given us. And they go through their life struggling, not knowing for sure if they're saved or born again. But here in 1 John 5, 14, we can have confidence, fearless confidence, boldness, and cheerful courage because we can know we have eternal life. I'm so glad because of this book, we know that we have access as our privilege, here in Romans chapter 5 and verse 2, by whom also we have access by faith unto this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. In hope, we can rejoice. In hope, we can stand. We can have a surety that we have access to this gracious gift of God. And how do we know How do we believe? Through the Word of God. Through this Word, through God's Word, we have peace. A peace that passeth all understanding. Romans 5:1 says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ. That's right. We were at war, if I may say, with Him. We were at war with Him. But ladies and gentlemen, one day the warring faction of Christ spoke to your heart, showed you how you were lost and undone, showed you that your sin was damning you for eternity, showed you that you needed a Savior and you needed a way of escape. And in us was a war. We can call it conviction, but nevertheless, there was a resistance to this holy God that was speaking to us. But eventually, one day, we threw up the white flag of surrender and said, Lord, I give up. If you don't mind, Lord, I want to stop warring with you. I want to stop fighting you. And I want to be at peace with you. And God, I just surrender my soul to you. And that day, Jesus came marching in with His grace and mercy and love, and with the drops of blood from Calvary's tree that He applied to your and my sin, He cleansed us and made us white as snow. That's what we learn from this Word. I tell you, we learn from this Word that we have union with Christ as our security. In Romans chapter 6, verse 5, for if we have planted together in likeness, in the likeness of His death, we shall be also in the likeness of His resurrection. Knowing this, how do we know this? Through the Word of God. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with Him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. How do we know this, Christian? The book. For he that is dead is freed from sin. May I say, when He died on the cross and the sins were nailed to the cross with Him, it was not His sin, it was your sin and it was my sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with Him. How do we know that when our sins were nailed to the cross, how do we know that when we came to Christ, He saved us? How do we know? We know through this book. How do we know that Christ, His advocacy, we have it as our care? How do we know? We know because of this book. In 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 and 2 says this, my little children, these things I write unto you. Did you hear that? These things I write unto you these instructions I give you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father. We have an advocate. We have a comforter. We have a helper. We have an assistant. We have a legal assistant. We have counsel for defense. So when we read this, if any man sin, we have an advocate. We have a comforter. We have a helper. We have an assistant. We have a counsel for defense with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. That's it. Jesus Christ, the righteous. When we sin, this word advocate means comforter. When we sin, we can go to him for comfort. Amen. When we sin, we can go to him for help because he's also a helper. When we sin, we can go to him for assistance because he can assist us in our matter. When we go to him, we can go to him because he is our counsel for defense. We sin. He goes before God the Father and says, Lord, Father, I only have one defense for what this brother has done. Lord, Father, I only have one defense for what this sister has done. Lord, you see what they've done. You see the sin. But Lord, I plead my blood upon that sin. I plead my blood on this imperfection. I shed my blood for this imperfect person. And Father, if you'll look through my blood, if you'll just look through my blood, Lord, you'll see them perfect as I see them. Father, won't you do that? And then because the Father loves the Son, because the Father loves the Comforter, because the Father loves the Helper, because the Father loves the legal assistant, because the Father loves the legal counselor, he looks through the blood also. And then he looks at our advocate and says, you know, I think you're right. I see no sin. I see no failure. I see no wrongdoing. I see no shortcomings because of our advocate. Praise the Lord. Bless his holy name. Our advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the propitiation of or for our sins. It means to cause to become favorable. It means to appease the offended one. Our sin defends a holy, righteous Father, and only Jesus Christ can appease the anger of a holy God. And he appeases it with the blood that he shed on Calvary's tree. That's what we learn through the Word of God. We sing about heaven. Hallelujah Square. Oh, what a wonderful time we'll all have up there. I tell you, one day we're going to get to heaven. And because of the blood, we're going to see that man or that woman. We're going to see the wheelchair bound doing the jig. I don't know what a jig is exactly, but I got to tell you, I believe the jig is done on the feet. One day, we're going to see the blind. Somebody that was once blind and couldn't see anything. Not long ago, I was driving through town, and I saw a man with his white stick sliding it back and forth, looking for that curb. Over at Ashley Park, I saw a fella with a stick. The other day, my wife and I believe it was Lisa. If it was a woman, I mean, it was Lisa. Or it was my daughter, or one of my daughters. Or it was William, I can't remember. Some gal came across with that stick sweeping back and forth, trying to find that curb. One day we're going to see those people who know the Lord drop the stick. And it all started with the blood. You know how I know that? It's in the book. We learned it from the book. I heard that. I don't know what it was, but I heard it. You know, the rapture is going to come just that quickly. We're going to be clicking along, and just as unexpectedly as that ring, whatever it was, happened, just that unexpectedly, we're going to be called home. If you don't know Jesus Christ, you're going to be sitting here by yourselves. You and my clothes. I would suggest that you come up and you get the keys to my office and you go and find my credit cards and debit cards and run them up, spend as much as you want to. Because I'm going to be up there. I'm going to see the cripple walk. My sister, she's so eaten up with rheumatoid arthritis, she cannot do her feet like this. She has to walk like a robot. Used to have to walk in the 60s. Now they've got them doing things like people. And a few years back, she called me crying. She said, I had a dream last night. She said, I dreamed I was running. And one day we're going to get to heaven. I'm going to see Cynthia maybe at a distance. She's not going to walk like this anymore. What do you think she's going to be doing? Running. You know how I know? What I learned from the book. We're going to get to see the blind see, the cripple walk. Those eaten up with diseases that can hardly walk, walk again. Run, jump, and praise God. And we know it by learning it from the book. My question is to you tonight, do you know this Jesus? Have you taken this information from the book literally? Have you said, you know, the Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Maybe I need to take that seriously. You know, the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Maybe I need to be taking that seriously. Maybe we need tonight to nail this thing of salvation down. Maybe you've been playing church. But deep in your heart, you know you're missing something. Maybe you're here tonight and you haven't been playing church. Maybe those that are around you, those that know you and love you, understand and know that you do not know Christ as your Lord and Savior. when I see the blind man see, and I see the cripple walk, and I see those that are sick. You know, when I got up singing that song today, Lisa said this, because it deals with the blind man, the cripple man, and then the dying man. Lisa said, you know what? She said, you know what? If cancer had been as prevalent in that day as it is today, I'm sure they would have written a verse about somebody that had cancer. Not going to be any more cancer in heaven, sports fans. You know how I know? Read it in the book. Do you know Christ tonight? Do you know him as your Lord and Savior? When we see the blind see again, we see the crippled walk, when we see those healed of disease, am I going to look across the throne room of heaven and see you there? There's a song. Dave, doesn't it say see something there? Maybe I'm thinking incorrectly. Maybe I'm wrong. Meet you there. Look for me. I tell you what, Brother Dave, don't you sing that song? Can you sing that song? Isn't it wonderful to put him on the spot for a change? Miss Lomax is running and shouting, honey, don't hang from the chandeliers now. We just hold it down. What about you? Are we going to meet you there? Can you say, Pastor, I know without a shadow of a doubt that if I were to die today, I'll meet you there. Can you raise your hands? Thank you. Last thing I want to do, and I will not embarrass anybody, but we're going to give an invitation. And if you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, right now you probably feel a little uncomfortable. See, that's the Holy Spirit dealing with your heart. But if you'll come and let me take God's word, or one of these ladies, if you're a lady, we'll show you how you can be born again right here tonight. Be saved. Wouldn't you like to be saved tonight? Wouldn't you like not to go to hell? Separation from God forever and ever and ever? Wouldn't you like to spend time in heaven with that husband or with that wife, with that daughter or with that son, or with that mother or with that father? Wouldn't you like to meet them there? Let's stand. The invitation is open. The altars are open. If you don't know Christ as your Savior, this is your chance.
When you finally make your entrance to that city of jasper walls and bright golden avenues,
yes,
as you behold all its beauty and its splendor, remember there's just one request I make of you. Look for me.
Amen.
For
can you raise your hand as testimony to that?
Too.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
I realize when you arrive, there'll be so much to view.
Amen.
After after you've been there 10,000 years, a million, maybe two, look for me, for I will be there too. As you go down your list of first, well, there's no question. You'll want to see all your loved ones waiting there for you. But when you feel you've shared your story with the last one that wants to hear you tell just how you made it through, look for me. I'd like to hear it too. I realize when you arrive, there'll be so much to view. After you've been there 10,000 years, a million, maybe two, look for me, for I will be there too. Look for me, for
I think the Lord's had his way in the service tonight, don't you?